Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us today. So thrilled to be here today with Darren Wallace, who is a PhD student in film and digital media here at UC Santa Cruz, and also a filmmaker and artist. I'm Rachel Nelson. I'm director of the Institute of the Arts and Sciences, and it's such a pleasure today to be here with Tina Campt, who we'll introduce in just a moment. First, I want to just say, before I turn it over to Darren, that Darren's going to be moderating today, and this is really going to be he's going to run the event, but I wanted to say first how thrilled we are to be here today with you and to be celebrating with this talk the fact that we finally got to open Just Futures, the exhibition curated by TJ Demos and featuring Arthur Jafa, Martine Sims, and Black Quantum Futurism at the Mary Porter Cezanne Art Gallery at UC Santa Cruz. So we thank TJ Demos, we thank Louise Leong, the gallery manager of the Cezanne, for helping put up this event together with us today. And we are so thrilled that after 2 years of being delayed, we were able to finally open that exhibition, which was supposed to open in March 2020. So Darren today is going to do introductions, and then we'll rejoin after Tina's talk for questions and answers and to have a conversation. So Darren, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Rachel. So yes, my name's Darren Wallace, and I'm also a graduate fellow working with IES and the Just Futures exhibition. And it's my pleasure to really introduce tonight's speaker and our guests. Their research has been incredibly wonderful and generative for my own research interests and my own academic and creative interests. And I'm sure what she has to share is going to be of value to everyone in attendance. So with that, would love to introduce Tina Campt for folks who may be unfamiliar. Tina Campt, a Black feminist theorist of visual culture and contemporary art, is Owen F. Walker Professor of Humanities and Modern Culture and Media at Brown University. Campt leads the Black Visualities Initiative at Kogut Institute for Humanities and is the founding convener of Practicing Refusal Collective and the Sojourner Project. She is the author of 4 books, Other Germans, Black Germans and the Politics of Race, Gender and Memory in the Third Reich, Image Matters, Archive, Photography and the African Diaspora in Europe, Listening to Images, and most recently, A Black Gaze. So with that said, I would love to welcome Tina Campt with us this evening. Thank you, Tina.
Thank you, Darren. Thank you, Rachel. And congratulations on the much delayed but really exciting opening of the show. I am devastated that I can't be there in person because it just sounds marvelous. I guess I'm going to start by just briefly saying hello to, there's a number of people among the participants that are old friends who I just want to say hi to, because for those of you who don't know, I spent a good long while of very wonderful time in my first position teaching at Santa Cruz. And so it's a pleasure, it's an honor, it's a privilege to be back in your company. So in honor of the exhibition, it's the show and its ambitions, the Just Futures Initiatives, I was asked to read from the new book, a section that is in conversation both with some of the aspirations of the project in terms of alternate articulations of Black futurity, but also in conversation with Arthur Jafa, an artist who I revere, who I admire, and who in many ways was, whose work was the inspiration for this particular book. So I'm going to read from the what's called a prelude, which in regular parlance is an introduction. But the way in which the book is organized is as a series of verses. The first of which is the prelude to the rest of the verses. And so it's called A Prelude to a Black Gaze, and I'm going to read a few excerpts. So, and I have the privilege of having somebody cue the slides for me. So a big appreciation for that. Okay, so I'm going to just launch into it. A Silent Serenade by Jay-Z and Beyoncé, live on stage, singing, serenading, flirting. It's sassy, it's sensual. She teases, he haunts, they both tantalize. She loves it, He clearly loves her for it, and we are captivated by their exchange of smiles and glances, and her twirls around and around him, layered over the sweet signature whisper of Al Green, cooing his love song, Come Lullaby, Judy. The footage is grainy, but its texture has nothing to do with age. Its grain comes from its visual frequency, which filmmakers, editors, and cinematographers commonly refer to as frame rate. In this case, it is an intentionally slowed frame rate that reveals the tender relations of both the scene and its subjects. This grainy slow motion clip gives an intimate framing to one of the most public Black couples on the planet. The sequence spans only, oops, go back one. we're going ahead of ourselves. Thank you, all right. The sequence spans only a few seconds, though it feels far longer, then erupts to interject live concert audio of call and response with Queen Bee stoking the audience's collective refrain. But this tantalizing scene is preceded by shattering footage. Film footage culled from Birth of a Nation toggles between cell phone footage of a Black man being beaten by a scrum of white police and CCTV footage showing a car mowing down a Black bystander in a parking lot. Interwoven amongst them is additional footage, cell phone video captured by ordinary people of street scenes, parties, and dancers drawn from an endless archive of found footage posted on various online sites. Next slide. A different cell phone video captures A different cell phone video captures a prepubescent boy belting out the opening lines of Nina Simone's signature rendition of Feeling Good with the vibrato of a 60-something blues singer from the backseat of a moving vehicle. It transitions to hyper-pixelated footage of Eartha Kitt mid-soliloquy, waxing characteristically defiant, poetic, and dismissive of love and relationships. Silent portraits of two Black feminist theorists flicker briefly between these and other unlikely scenes, leaving unanswered questions in their lingering shadows. And a bleach blonde Black man, filmed against a blindingly white background, bears witness to hearing the voice of the Almighty speak to him in the moment of his temporary death after taking a bullet. He recounts his reflections with the wisdom of a shaman and the charm of a playa. The video for Jay-Z's 444, its 2017 release, is chock full of love and loss, beauty and brutality, Black pleasure and Black precarity. Although produced as a visual and commercial vehicle for the song, the video is in no way beholden to it. It is a work that inverts the relationship between image and song by transforming the music into a vehicle for the astonishing montage of images created by Arthur Jafa and the T-Neg Collective. It coalesces around a series of visual duets that intertwine pleasure and despair and juxtapose the extremities of Black life in the 21st century. We see these extremities through the intentionally grainy frame of Jafa's cinematic lens. It is a grain that emerges when the diminutive frame of cell phone video is expanded to a much larger screen. But it's also a grain that we feel as much as we see it. We feel the rough, unfocused grain produced by zooming in for a hyper close-up on cell or CCTV footage of a beating or a drive-by. We feel the grain of a zoom in that allows us to appreciate the artistry of an impromptu subway performance, an improvised party dance at a party, or a backseat solo performance. We feel it in the halo-like blur that results when a master cinematographer shows us the power of the everyday visualizing practices of ordinary Black folks' amateur videos. They are videos that allow us to see ourselves as discerning and uncompromising witnesses who adamantly refuse to look away. 444 whiplashes us between giggles and gasps, winces and sighs. Yet what weaves the emotional extremes of this 8-minute collage together and connects the mosaic of clips it gathers to the lyrical apology JC professes in the song is a breathtaking physical duet created by the coordinated sinews of muscle and flesh of two extraordinary movement artists, acclaimed flex dancer Storyboard P and MacArthur Award winner Okwui Okpokwasili. The two did not rehearse prior to the take included in the video. They were asked instead to dance simultaneously in tandem. What emerges is an organic symbiosis and a spontaneous interaction. They never touch, but there is contact nonetheless. The correlation of their bodies is something more than a dance and more than a choreography. It is a corporeal negotiation of intimacy and distance, tension, tenderness, and rage. Storyboard and Okpokwasili's fleshly improvisation mirrors the emotional apology that is the dominating lyric of 444. Placed in the context of the larger stream of visual duets it gathers, the video offers a different kind of mirror. It is a mirror on Black sociality. It is a mirror that reflects and refracts an uncomfortable portrait of Black life in the United States at a moment when its most stunning and honest visualizations are those that twin the joys of the Black quotidian with the pain of Black precarity. The video captures Okpokwasili running languidly, then fluidly, at times seeming as if she's about to launch into flight. But most of the time she remains in place, vibrating intensely. Her body ripples, her neck rolls. She appears to rotate on her own axis. She undulates at a distance from Storyboard, then grazes him closely. She turns away, then faces off in a confrontation that pivots back and forth between aggression and intimacy, conflict and vulnerability, apprehension and deep affection. As Storyboard passes behind, alongside, or in front of her, the motion of his body suspends time and seems to deny the physics of the corporeal relation between skeleton and flesh. He moves neither vertically nor horizontally. His body flows like a viscous material that mediates solid and liquid. He flows, she flows, and as I argue in the verses that follow, Black flow is creating a radical Black gaze, or put another way, we flow. Now they're going to cue up the video to share with you.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, and I'm feeling good.
Do I find it so hard?
A relationship is a relationship that has to be earned. And I love relationships. I think they're fantastic. They're wonderful. I think they're great. I think there's nothing in the world more beautiful than falling in love. But falling in love for the right reasons, falling in love for the right purpose, falling in love, falling in love.
Tell the truth, man, I didn't feel nothing. I was just laid on the ground with a shot in my stomach, and I was just like, Lord, just don't let me go out like this. Don't take me like this. And that's the first time I actually subconsciously heard them talk back to me. And I remember the exact statement. I'll never forget it. He said, I'm not going to take you. I showed you too much to take you now. You're not done.
Yeah. why then?
You spinning my joint? Bruh, did you spinning my joint? Like off no hype shit, bruh. Cause you my man and I fuck with you. But if you
nigga, no!
I apologize. Orphan woman eyes. Took for my child to be born. See through a woman's eyes. Took for these natural twins to believe in miracles. Took me too long for this song. I don't deserve you. I harass you out in Paris. Please come back to Rome, you make it home. We talked for hours when you were on tour. Please pick up the phone, pick up the phone. I said don't embarrass me instead of be mine. That was my proposal for us to go steady. That was your 21st birthday. You matured faster than me, I wasn't ready. So I apologize, I seen the innocence. Leave your eyes, I still mourn this death. And I apologize for all the stillborns, cause I wasn't present, your body wouldn't accept it. I apologize to all the women whom I toyed with your emotion, cause I was emotionless. And I apologize, cause at your best, you were love. And because I fall short of what I say I'm all about, your eyes leave with the soul that your body once housed. And you stare blankly into space, thinking of all the time you wasted it on all this basic shit. So I apologize. Apologize. Our love was one for the ages, and I contained us in all this ratchet shit, and we more expansive now. Meant to cry and die alone in these mansions, or sleep with our back turned. We supposed to vacate till our backs burn. We're supposed to laugh till our hearts stop, and then me in a space where the dark stop, and let love light the way. Like the men before me, I cut off my nose to spite my face. I never wanted another woman to know something about me that you didn't know. I promise I cried, I couldn't hold. I suck at love, I think I need a do-over. I would be emotionally available if I invited you over. I stew over, what if you over my shit?
I mean, I'm sure in some ways it's fun, yeah.
Actually, I am dealing with a little existential crisis here. Am I alive? Do I actually exist? Will I die?
I never thought dreams could happen. Since I met you, since I met you, life has been wrong. Yeah, I never thought I could welcome. No, baby, to other heart as I do.
Hey. And if my children knew, I don't even know what I would do. If they ain't looking me the same, I would probably die with all the shame. You did what with who? What good is a menage a trois when you have a soulmate? You risk that for blue? If I wasn't a superhero on your face, my heart breaks for the day I have to explain my mistakes. And the mask goes away, and Santa Claus is fake. And you go online and see, for Blues 2, the Tooth Fairy didn't pay.
So could you bring back the slide where the clip was embedded? Lindsay, thank you. Thank you. Watching 444 isn't easy. It doesn't tell a story. It narrates neither the lyric of the song nor the sexy hip hop life of bubbles and bling. You have to work to understand the connections between its various clips and sequences. I get goosebumps listening to the vibrato of that young boy sitting in the back seat of a car. It's chilling to watch a scene of a Black boy on an auction block culled from Birth of a Nation. It hurts to watch video footage of police officers' relentless abuse of a Black man spliced so seamlessly into clips of parties and concerts. And it's harrowing to watch a body bounce off the hood of a moving car careening around a corner, intentionally hitting a bystander. But 444 is a video we both want and need to see. Its beauty and its power is that it requires us to be present. Watching it requires us to cycle through discomfort in order to appreciate its moments of sublime reverie. Reverie in Black love, in Black survival, and in a future we were never promised, yet claim and cling to vigorously and vociferously. It's a discomforting, aspirational, defiant gaze. It is a Black gaze. This book, A Black Gaze, sketches the contours of this emergent Black gaze, focusing on a group of artists whose creative practice produces radical forms of witnessing that reject traditional ways of seeing Blackness, ways of seeing that historically depict Blackness only in a subordinate relation to whiteness. What defines and unites their divergent practices is their ability to make audiences work. They refuse to create spectators, as it is neither easy nor indeed possible to passively consume their art. Their work requires labor, the labor of discomfort, feeling, positioning, and repositioning, and it solicits visceral responses to the visualization of Black precarity. This book asks us to consider what kind of work these artists ask us to do and what kind of labor it requires of us. Posing these questions means asking what is at stake in their work, as well as what are the stakes of creating this particular kind of art. My answer is that these artworks demand a different kind of response, or more precisely, a particular kind of responsiveness. They insist that we actively inhabit states ranging from disorientation and unease to implication and vulnerability, and that we work through these responses to come out somewhere new and important. They demand a recognition that we are implicated in the precarity of Black life in the contemporary moment. In embracing or refusing to embrace this implication, we are faced with a choice: act or be complicit. It is a recognition that requires us to develop a different way of engaging art by way of a Black gaze that mandates our participation in and interaction with the social and political questions these works raise in ways that leave us vulnerable to their effects and better off for it. A Black gaze is a structure of visual engagement that implicitly and explicitly understands Blackness as neither singular nor a singularity. It embraces instead the multiplicity of Blacknesses artists simultaneously grapple with and personify. Here, my choice of the indefinite article is intentional, for I am proposing that we think about a Black gaze rather than the Black gaze, and understand it as both multiple and polyvalent. It is at once a critical framework, a reading apparatus, a term that describes an artist's practice, and a spectatorial mediation that demands particularly active modes of watching, listening, and witnessing. This more capacious idea of a gaze opens up a different set of possibilities, for understanding other potentialities of a Black gaze. It unleashes some of the multiple meanings of the gaze that are impossible to imagine when it is understood as always already tethered to a prior injury or a structure of dominance. Rather than trying to invent a new term for the transformative practices of witnessing and implication created by artists engaged in these pages, rather than reducing them to alternative forms of looking, I choose instead to embrace the radical power of their work as constituting a Black gaze. It is a gaze that sets in motion a choreography of practices that are constantly up for grabs. And it is in this spirit of this open-ended choreography that I propose the idea of a Black gaze while at the same time acknowledging that it is a challenging shift in our understanding of what looking and seeing mean at this pivotal historical moment. Exploring the contradictions between our current inundation with images of precarious Black life and seemingly disposable Black bodies on the one hand, and the equally striking ascendance of Black aesthetics, both in popular culture and the art world on the other, the verses that follow summon readers to confront the deeply entrenched forms of racism and white supremacy we face at this urgent conjuncture. They should be read as a provocation to reckon with the paradox of being Black in the 21st century that, as Christina Sharp explains, requires us to, quote, recognize the ways that we are constituted through and by continued vulnerability to overwhelming force, though not only known to ourselves and to each other by that force. Recognizing that Black life is constituted through vulnerability to the overwhelming forces of anti-Blackness and white supremacy, and yet not capitulating to only be known by these same forces, is a tall order. It necessitates that we refuse to be overwhelmed by historical and contemporary forces of negation that have shaped the lives of Black people since the advent of modernity. But the fact that we have actually developed these skills and capacities is both the fundamental point of origin for the idea of a Black gaze and an affirmation that it does indeed exist. The creativity, ingenuity, cunning, and courage that allow us to acknowledge the forces that would define us and yet not succumb to that definition is the modus operandi of a Black gaze. In the end, I realize that a Black gaze might seem a fundamental contradiction in terms that some may be unwilling to accept. Steeped as it is in white male desire as the privileged perspective of viewing and lodged so profoundly in the logics of the plantation, one might understandably ask, as did early readers of the book manuscript, whether the concept of the gaze is capable of doing the work I'm proposing. Indeed, Jafa himself has maintained that, quote, if you point a camera at a Black person on a psychoanalytic level, it functions as a white gaze. It therefore triggers a whole set of survival modalities that Black Americans have. It doesn't matter if a Black person is behind the camera or not, because the camera itself is an instrument of the white gaze, end quote. Now, while it may seem as if I want to have it both ways, I would still argue that Jafa's statement is accurate and yet at the same time does not preclude the emergence of a Black gaze, even in his own work. And here I must also cop to the fact that I've been drawn to counterintuitive concepts for a long time, as they've always offered me a powerful source of inspiration. Counterintuition requires us to think beyond our comfort zone, to think oppositions in tandem, and to think them in a different grammar, not the grammar of the declarative, this is, but in the grammar of my favorite tense, the subjunctive tense of the future real conditional. It is not a provisional tense, but one premised on the realization of a different future. It is the tense of as if. It is an intentional deployment of aspiration that strives toward a multitude of possibilities. the future real conditional, or that which will have had to have happened. That which will have had to happen, sorry, have had to happen, is proceeding as if. It proceeds as if our aspirations were being or had already been realized. It is a radical provocation to see Blackness differently, and in doing so, to create a path to living Blackness differently, not in the future, but now. Thank you. You have to unmute.
Thank you so much. That was just wonderful. I really love the way in which we are able to think through the gaze through your text, not as a function of visual mastery or not looking for pleasure, but really as an invitation to be transformed through our vulnerability. So thank you so much for this intervention that you've staged here. So now we're going to transition into our question and answer session. For our viewers in attendance, feel free to drop your question within the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. And as folks are thinking of some wonderful questions, I kind of have some of my own. Yes, Tina, I wonder if we could talk a little bit about Arthur Jaffa. And in particular, he often states how his creative intention is to create Black cinema with the power, beauty, and alienation of Black music. And I'm really curious, how do you receive that intention through Jafa's aesthetic strategies operating across his film works, but especially in 444? And if you could tell us a little bit about how this intention to create Black cinema with the power of Black music, how that may intersect with your own research into the frequency of images.
Yeah, you know, I talk about this in the book a little bit, which is that there was kind of a Vulcan mind meld between AJ and me when we first met, because I describe my work as trying to think about the frequency of images. And that resonated with him because of precisely that, that articulation of his own cinematic aspiration, that when we think of frequency as a register that is sonic, that is visual, that is haptic, that is kinetic, that is temporal, right? Frequency in terms of the repetition of something that is not only a replication, right? That kind of temporal repetition is frequency in that, you know, as an adjective, as an adverb, I think it is. But it's also the capacity to vibrate, which is to be affected in a way that you have to physically respond in resonance, right? And that the relationship to sound, right, is haptic as well as temporal, a temporal register of repetition. And so the connection that I have, and that actually AJ's work allowed me to develop, was to be able to actually account for the responses that exceed an image, right? And so in some ways, I'm often hesitant to talk about 444, because it is, you know, the immediate response is, well, yeah, it's a music video. And that is inherently a degradation, right? It's inherently a put down, but it's just a music video. As if they're in music videos, or what we think of as music video, there's a kind of one-to-one correlation between music and image, right? And the reason that I actually do like to talk about it is because it severs that. There isn't that relationship between lyric, sound, and image. That even that, especially in this video, the song itself is disrupted by things that have nothing to do with it. Basquiat, right? And that sort of mimicry of Basquiat, or the kind of internal monologue of Basquiat's therapist, you know, being parroted by a puppet, right? The interlude of Al Green, right? The interlude of the Playa, right? Talking about his particular, and the interlude of all these moments of sonic and visual disruption, right? So to me, one of the ways that that AJ's work allows me, you know, a perfect opportunity to talk about something that I call visual frequency, right, is the way in which he's trying that he's trying to get us to think beyond the image through sound, right? Because the beauty, power, and alienation of Black music is not just it sounds good, right? It feels good. It moves me, right? The alienation part is the part that people often don't want to account for, right? We can understand, you know, we can totally connect to the beauty and power of Black music, but the alienation part is really important. And I feel like one of the things that he does in this particular video that he does on a larger scale in Love is the Message or in Apex or A Kingdom Cometh As or his more recent work, Akitra, right, is that he forces us through the alienation as well as the beauty and the power. And that that particular triumvirate, right, is important to embrace. And for me, that is the most important thing about that sentence that he aspires to. Beauty, power, alienation. Don't forget about that. And if you can go to the alienation, then you can actually grasp more profoundly the beauty and the power.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you. We have some wonderful questions rolling right on in. So just sticking with 444, we have an interesting question from the audience regarding how does the Black gaze operate in spaces that are mixed in terms of like their demographics or just white dominated art institutions. And this person asks specifically, how does the Black gaze operate in this mixed view of space? Does it negate or ignore the white gaze? Yes, I'm curious if you have any thoughts on how the Black gaze may function considering what space folks encounter it in.
Right, and so I guess I have to be a little bit clearer about what I mean by the Black gaze, right? That I'm trying to talk about not necessarily a structure, right? I'm talking about a dynamic, and I'm talking about a way in which a demand for responsiveness, right, issues forth from certain kinds of artwork. So when I describe it as a set of viewing relations, that's different than a structure, right? A practice of looking, right? And it's not a perspective. It is something that undermines these structures of dominance. It's something that undermines a perspective. And so when I'm talking about when you're asking about the mixed spaces, right, you're asking to me, if I'm putting it in my context, you're asking about the relationship between a white view or white perspective and a non-white perspective. But what I'm talking about in terms of a Black gaze is when that perspective itself is undermined to the extent that as somebody who is implicated, right, in white supremacy, not necessarily an active agent of it, right, but implicated by a perspective that shows the negative power, the negating power of whiteness and white supremacy, right, then it's not about a competition between those gazes. It's about your accountability in witnessing that, right, in witnessing that power. And so when I say one is confronted with a choice, act or be complicit, I'm saying, okay, what you're confronted with is being implicated. What do you do with that? What do you do with that? And I'm also not saying that the implication is restricted to white people. Like, I am implicated in many of these scenes of Black precarity. And that one of the things that I'm saying that a Black gaze does is it calls on us to embrace that in a way that is potentially transformative. And that potential for transformation to me, that is the Black gaze. It's not a competition of perspectives of do I see it this way or do I see it that way. It's about to what extent can I take on my positioning in relationship to what I am seeing and how that politically breaks down.
Thank you so much. And thinking through other oppositional kind of gazes, practices. We have a wonderful question from Jennifer Gonzalez. And just thinking through the memory of bell hooks, they wanted to ask about the relationship between the oppositional gaze that she develops as a way of looking at cinema and the Black gaze that you're offering, which are quite different, but maybe you could explore the nuances and the differences between these analytics.
Yeah, I mean, I you know, moment of silence for bell hooks, God bless, because, you know, she set us on this path. She set us on this path, her and folks like Mancia Diawara, and, you know, resisting spectatorship, right? And so I guess where I'm trying to depart from bell hooks is that she's talking about the look back, right? And she's talking about the practice of looking against and seeing something else. And so I took quite literally, I mean, I went back to that foundational essay, and I took it like quite literally as she's talking about the ways in which Black people make something else of what they are offered, right? She's talking about the way in which the gaze that excluded Black people, right? How she was raised, you know, doing something different with that, that her entire community did something different with that. They wrote themselves in, right? They could laugh at and alongside, right? And that they were creating a space of agency where there was none. I don't think we're there anymore. I think we're at another place. And I think that, and again, I'm saying that I'm being relatively specific to a contemporary shift that I see, which is no longer to try and create a Black person's gaze, right? But to create a position we're in, right? Everybody is positioned in relationship to one another. And that positioning is not equitable. But again, it's a flip of it, right? Where the equity, right? Those who are trying to claim equity are those who were structured to have it all along, right? And so that is kind of the shift that I'm making from the kind of cinematic or popular cultural structures of viewing practices that did not allow Black people a place, to a moment where we see so many representations of Blackness, right? But not all of them are unproblematic, right? Even those created by Black artists. And so what I'm trying to say is that I see this other thing developing that is not about simply the representation or the proliferation of representations of Black people, right? We've got that all over the place. But at the same time, I don't think that the proliferation of Black people on screens is going to help us necessarily. It's about how do those representations undermine structures of domination? How do they create a situation where we must respond? So that, I think that's an answer, and I could go on and on forever because Jennifer always asks excellent questions.
No, that was brilliant. Thank you. I'm considering the moment that we're in right now, and have you already spoken to this, but the oversaturation somewhat of just Black bodies circulating, whether in distress or whether in ecstasy. But I'm really curious about the lineage of the Black gaze. So just considering just the lineage of interventions into visual culture staged by many different Black artists, from the Black artist movement to the LA rebellion, I'm curious, what other conditions have really allowed a Black gaze to emerge in this particular moment and climate?
I say explicitly that my articulation of this thing I'm calling a Black gaze is not new, right? It is cumulative, and it is a direct inheritor of things like, you know, the Harlem Renaissance, the, you know, the New Negro, the Black Arts Movement, LA Rebellion, like all of these different artistic interventions that created openings, right? Openings. Right now, I think that what we're experiencing is the democratization and the proliferation of visual culture through social media, on the one hand, and then at the same time, and that is about the self-production of images, right, in a radically democratic way and a radically unfiltered way, which is both the creative possibility, but also the documentary possibility of capturing violence, and the precarity of Black bodies. In addition to that, you have a moment when Black artists, fine artists, are suddenly being able, are finally being recognized, but recognized at a different level, which is among institutions that would not embrace them. At a level of, Simone Leigh talks about it as critical mass, right? It's not, there always was one, or, you know, there was always one or two here, there, and everywhere. But critical mass right now, where, you know, Simone Leigh as the US Venice representative, as, you know, Deana Lawson and Simone Leigh as Hugo Boss Prize winners, Arthur Jafa as winner of the Golden Lion at Venice, right? So like all of this is happening. And what I see is the fact that you have it from below and above, right? You have it in fine art and you have it at the quotidian level of regular folks making art and calling to account and using visuality to call the forces of white supremacy to account. So when those two things happen together, right, it's something very, very interesting that happens. And, you know, and then add to that the pandemic and the fact that that brought all of the racial tensions that were, you know, not percolating, they were just like at a hot boil, right? And it blew the lid off. And so what again, it's not an accident that that is the result of the video capture, right? Both of extraordinary violence, right? And of, I'm sorry, a little fly, and of, right, extraordinary protest, right? Rebellion. We have been witnessing rebellion for quite some time. So to me, the idea of a Black gaze was germinating for me for a while in relationship to that contradiction, that I'm seeing so much violence visually, and at the same time, I'm seeing so much beauty being created. And that both of those things are troubling, right? There's a way in which it is intolerable to have to look at these images of violence so rapidly, so repetitively, and at the same time to be able to witness the creation of such extraordinary beauty simultaneously. And so what I was trying to understand was, you know, what is the impact of that? And the impact for me was I had to keep working, right? I had to be able to work through all of the pain and all of the struggle, right? That I wasn't being allowed to consume anything easily, and that that's having an impact in how we look and how we engage Black visual culture in this moment. And I was trying to account for that labor, that effective labor, by talking about a Black gaze.
Thank you. I'm thinking right now, particularly around the engagement of the quotidian throughout Jafa's work and also the other artists who you highlight throughout your text. And I'm curious, because so often throughout works of political theory, as well as pop cultural renderings of historical change, often that process is really visualized as this grand galactic struggle for power. And I'm really curious, what might these artists' engagement with the quotidian, with the vernacular intimacy of Black being, offer political imaginaries in this moment?
I think what it offers, is the validation that everyday practices of survival are what create a different future, the possibility of a different future, I think we are beyond charismatic leaders. The charismatic leaders that we encounter have either been an extraordinary disappointment or have been megalomaniacs, and that our future lies in cultivating practices of care at an everyday level that then become radical acts of intervention and change making. So, you know, I'm a person who believes in the politics of refusal. I'm not necessarily a person who believes in the politics of movements led by charismatic people. That one of the things that I want to do is I want to reclaim those everyday acts of rebellion and radicality, because those are what change our lives, right? And if we can refuse the seduction of charisma, if we can refuse the seduction of thinking that everything that happens in the world happens only by way of a massive movement, the quotidian becomes something that is incredibly powerful and empowers people to make change at every level that they can, every level that they can. And it is not insignificant, the changes that they make, that they are able to make.
Thank you for laying it out brilliantly. So often we forget about our everyday engagement with others and how we cultivate care and how that is an actual political act of survival. Thank you so much for uplifting that. We have about two more questions. I have, as you know, about seven more, but I want to get to some of these audience questions. We have this one coming in from Alex Jones. Okay, so Alex states that, my question is about tracing routes of the Black gaze or gazes as you see them across your texts. Your thinking around Jafa's comments regarding the camera and Blackness orients us towards the artist and photographer to subject passage. But more specifically, the question, how does your framework with the counteractive gaze, the Black subject to the camera, does the Black gaze precede the moment of imaging? Is it suspended in the visual object? Do gazes multiply between participants?
Yes. No, that was a joke. I'm sorry, but since nobody's laughing except for me, I will actually answer the question, which is, it does not precede. It does not precede the subject. It does not precede the interaction. The Black gaze is engendered through that exchange, right? It is a responsiveness. That's one of the ways in which I describe it, is that it is a solicitation to a form of responsiveness that breeds some kind of positioning, right? So it is inherently about the production of a relationship to something else. So that goes to the second part of the question, which is yes, they do proliferate. They do ricochet, right? They do come to have a certain kind of dynamic that I think can engender a different relationship to those Black bodies that are being imaged.
Thank you. Let's see, we have about time for maybe two more questions. We have a brilliant question from Professor Iman Wang. She writes, the way you conceptualize Black gaze is very intriguing. To me, it sounds like some form of structure of feeling. Could you describe how the Black gaze can be enabled or willed aesthetically and socio-politically?
That is a challenging question. Yes, it is a structure. It is an effective structure, right? So I would love to actually see it. I'm just going to try and is it under is it in the chat or is it in the
chat? I'll drop it right in the chat.
Okay. Okay, where is it?
Let's see. Oh, 1 second. It's in the answer.
I can see the Q&A as well. I just can't see that one.
Oh, that question moved to the answered section. Okay, so I'm going to drop it in the chat right now.
Okay, here we go. It's back. Where is it? No, I don't. Okay, wait a minute. Hang on. Oh, because of how it sounds like some form of a structure of feeling. Yes, a structure of feeling. Could you describe how the Black gaze can be enabled or wielded aesthetically and sociopolitically? Wielded. So when I'm thinking about that question or response to that question, I'm thinking about the artist Luke Willis Thompson, and I'm thinking about his work Autoportrait, or another work Cemetery of Live Reason Funeraries, and where he's actually doing these close-up, what I call still moving images. So they are filmed images of stilled individuals who are the survivors of people who have been murdered by black people, who have been murdered by police. So they are their partners or their sons or their grandsons. And what we have to do in those long still films is confront the gazes and the grief of those who were left behind by police violence. So the wielding of aesthetic or of a Black gaze aesthetically or sociopolitically may not look like politics, may not look like that, but again, as an effective structure of feeling, right? How do we respond to withstanding the gaze of somebody who has lost, who has experienced a profound loss that could be ours, right? That could be ours. And that's where I go to the living as if, And when writing about the work of Dawoud Bey, who does this amazing chronicle of Birmingham, the Birmingham Project, and about what he juxtaposes are portraits of individuals who were the same age of the little girls who died with portraits of those who are the same age of the girls that died. And one of the things that I write about that is that conversation between the children who were the same age who are now adults and the children who are the same age who are right now children is what it makes us think about, is how they are living as if it could have been them, because it still could be them, right? Those who were alive and who were potential victims of Birmingham back in that moment, right, live their lives as if that could have been them, because it could have been. And those who are the children who are the same age as those girls when they died are living as if it could be them, because we know right now it could be. The same thing could happen right now. And so to wield, I mean, it's a little more instrumental than I can actually describe, but a structure of feeling is not about wielding something. It is about being accountable to how that structure can transform you effectively and motivate you to living a different future.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, and for our last question, comes in from Rashida Witter. She says, "Hi, Tina. It's always a pleasure to hear you speak. Infinite gratitude for the work that you do. I love that a Black gaze concludes with the notion of radical Black joy. Can you cite any recent encounters of radical Black joy? And also, can you speak about the role that radical Black joy plays in liberatory practices?"
Radical Black joy. I mean, it's funny because Arthur Jafa explicitly talks about Black pleasure, right? And I think that in Jen and Kiru's work, it is joy, because one of the things she focuses on are children, right? Children just doing that kind of, you know, watching them. There's this one scene of these two little girls that are dancing. They're just dancing like this. And you can't hear the music, but you can see their heads bobbing. And you can see that they are just completely swept up in something beyond them that is so pure, right? And so radical, that's why I call that chapter Radical Black Joy, because it is about something that's not necessarily intentional or chosen. It's about allowing oneself to be swept away by possibility. On the other hand, I agree with AJ in terms of, we also need to think about Black pleasure as an intentional consumption, right? As an intentional articulation of desire, right? And that for me, that is the role that it plays, that you have this dual thing about, we can't just think about joy as this, you know, almost spontaneous occurrence that we need to, you know, embrace when it comes. We have to also be as intentional about seeking pleasure as the fulfillment of desires that we have been taught we're not entitled to. So I think that that Black pleasure and Black joy are central to liberatory practice, because otherwise we're just fighting. Otherwise it's only struggle. And that joy and pleasure are forms of care that we have to grant ourselves, and we have to encourage ourselves to embrace.
Thank you so much. Let's see, we may have time to maybe sneak in one more. Getting kind of close to the end. One thing I actually really would love for you to speak about, Tina, is your studio writing practice, the way in which you write to these artworks. I really love A Black Gaze for the way in which it models a different engagement of these works. So I'm curious if you could speak to how this studio writing practice may call us to engage museum spectatorship in otherwise normative ways.
Yeah, I mean, what I talk about writing to images is literally writing in the room with them. I mean, I start writing about artwork in the gallery. And I take that space to be able to write through what I am seeing, hearing, feeling, experiencing. And that, again, that is a practice that makes me accountable to the image itself and to the relationship or the interaction with it in the space that where an artist has decided to show it on their own terms. Right. That's something also that's really important about the gallery, is that you have art that is installed the way the artist wants us to see it, which is very different than looking at something on a screen. Right. So so it was actually Deana Lawson who told me that this practice of writing that I have, like sitting on the floor of a gallery and writing for hours about artwork, that is like making the gallery into my own studio. And I like that. it's also about taking up space in a gallery, and it positions me in relationship to other spectators. So as much as I am writing to the images, I'm also writing to what's happening in the gallery, which is, you know, which makes me understand something more about the artwork itself and the artist as well. I mean, I was trained as a historian and an oral historian, and so I was trained to listen to people. I was also, you know, trained in ethnography. So thinking about how we encounter each other is really important, and I just transferred that to art. That it is as important to think about how other people are inhabiting the space with me and having the space with artwork. Because I think that says something. And so as I watch people watching films, I watch people watching artwork, and it is a profound experience. I recently was writing about an installation at the Palais de Tokyo in Paris by Maxwell Alexander, which is this massive installation where he creates within a white cube space his own exhibition and his own gallery within that gallery, but that gallery is populated by Black people. All on all of these massive canvases, you see Black people in a museum enjoying art. And so that experience of writing in that sort of mirror studio is a double studio, it's a studio within, no, it's a gallery within a gallery. And one of the things that I saw was I was the only Black person in that gallery for 2 hours. But I was in the gallery, in Alexander's gallery, with only Black people. And the ways in which he was trying to get us to think about how we inhabit the white cube, right, as Black subjects, as white subjects, it was just extraordinary. And the other thing that was so extraordinary about it was that it was like a hall of mirrors, but this doubling effect happened, which I watched it and I filmed it, which was on the canvas gallery, the paper gallery, you would see Black security guards, and you would see them sort of following people or watching people. And in the gallery itself, the real gallery, you would see Black security guards. They were the only other Black people in the gallery other than me. And I'd watch the scene unfold in a canvas that would unfold in the gallery. And so again, that's my practice, is to actually sit there and try and have an ethnographic experience with art that is conversational, that is a dialogue.
Wow. Thank you. We have a wonderful follow-up question in thinking through your process of writing to these images. From Catherine Rucker, she wonders, have you ever had to work through a level of exhaustion in writing about these images, considering just how intense they may be? And also she asks, have you ever had a fallout of love with any of these images or works that you encounter?
Yes, with everyone. With every single one, yes. And exhaustion, true. Yeah, I mean, it's more, I write from the space of exhaustion because it gets me to another place. It gets me to a place of comprehension, right? The place that I start out with is sort of being overwhelmed by something and writing my way through that overwhelm. And that gets me to understand what I am responding to. I mean, the other thing that I would add is that the dialogues that I'm trying to establish through my writing practice are dialogues that I'm trying to use as an invitation to others to participate in a similar kind of practice. So I am really quite specifically trying to say, you know, because I'm also not trained as an art historian, I had to work my way up to allowing myself to write about art. I mean, I wrote about photography, right? Photography, vernacular photography. That's not art photography. That's the exact opposite of art photography. And so part of my process is to try and give both myself and others permission to acknowledge what art does to us if we allow it to, and to be able to make use of that in a constructive, no, not a constructive, in a transformative way.
Thank you. One of the, I feel, imperatives that the Black gaze offers us is that it acts as kind of work through that exhaustion, right? To kind of move through that fatigue. It kind of calls us to kind of care for Black precarity and to kind of position ourselves in relationship to that. So thank you for kind of modeling that for us. All right, I have one final question, I promise.
There's a lot of final questions in this round.
I just want to kind of think about the overall exhibition and its overall aims and thinking of futurity and thinking about Arthur Jaffa's work, as well as the other artists that you write about throughout your text of Black gaze. It seems that many of them have practices that really refuse mere documentation or preservation in their approach to archival materials. And I'm wondering if you could speak to how speculation or critical fabulation may operate in these works as they try to uncover new uncanny perspectives and relationships. And to that point, if you could share a little bit about how fabulation may shape how you receive and write about these works.
That was about 7 different questions.
Okay.
Okay. You actually, I need to disaggregate a few of those questions because I'm thinking about them. Okay. To start out with documentation and preservation, that Arthur Jaffa, you know, he for sort of right around the beginning of when Love is a Message was like getting big play and big buzz. It was, you know, I remember he said, I don't want to be thought of as the found footage guy, right? It's like, you know, one of the things that everyone was saying is that, okay, he's done all this about found footage, you know? And it's true that there is a collecting archival process that AJ, you know, is just addicted to, the accumulation and the fascination with the beauty, the strangeness, the freakiness of what people will upload online to YouTube, right? And that is its own archive, you know, for better or for worse. But the way in which he uses montage to bring together those things that have nothing to do with each other, right? Is a process of fabulation, but it's a process of fabulation that is an invitation to interpret, right? Invitation to create your own narrative. And creating your own narrative as a projection into the future as you would like yourself to be seen, right? And to me, again, the future real conditional is a fabulation in the sense of Saidiya Hartman's understanding of fabulation, which is, right, to refuse the archive's power to define us by reading through the archive and through its erasures and omissions, right? And so its erasures and omissions are that which it will not let you see because it cannot accommodate their complexity. And that to me is a path to not reinterpreting your past, but using your past to create a different possibility for living otherwise. So again, fabulation is about creating a different future. It's about writing differently, writing your life differently, writing the trajectory of a community differently. So yeah, so I think it's actually quite crucial and thoroughly thoroughly imbricated and bound up in each other. Yeah. Is that really the last question?
Yes, I promise. Oh, <yeah. laughs> Thank you so much for your brilliant responses and all your care and wisdom. Yes, that really crystallizes the entire kind of theme of the exhibition and thinking about the relationship between futurity and speculation and a more liberatory future for us all. Thank you so much, Tina.
Very, very much.
I get to say thank you to both of you. Darren, thank you so much for inviting Tina and facilitating this for us. And Tina, thank you so much for coming back to Santa Cruz. It's been such a pleasure. And next time, real life. We can assist. So
with ocean and sun and warmth and sky. I'll be there.
Thank you so much and have a wonderful evening. I know it's much later for you than it is for us.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.